So welcome in the class of water systems engineering. So today's lecture we are going to see the hydrology. I am Mr. S. S. Sogule, assistant professor civil engineering department. Now, so what is the hydrology? Hydrology is the multidisciplinary subject that deals with the occurrence, circulation and distribution of waters on the earth. So the part of this we have seen already in the water cycle or hydrological cycle. So basically, what are the sources of water on the earth? So about 97.25% water has been stored in oceans. Then in ice caps and glaciers, 2.05% water has been stored. In groundwater, 0.68% water is there. In lakes, 0.01% water is there. In soil moisture, 0.005% water is there. In atmosphere, 0.001% water is there. And in streams and rivers, 0.0001% water is there. So see how the water has been distributed and how much water is available for our use. Now, where this hydrology has been applied? So hydrology has been applied to the major civil engineering projects such as irrigation schemes, dams and hydroelectric power projects, and water supply projects. Scope of hydrology is help us to know the maximum probable fluid that may occur at a given site and its frequency. This is required for the safe design of the drains and culverts, dams and reservoirs, channels and other flood control structures. The water yield from basin, its occurrence quantity and the frequency, etc. This is necessary to design a dams, municipal water supply, water power and river navigation, etc. The groundwater development, for which a knowledge of the hydrology of the area, that is the formation of soil, the recharge facilities like streams, reservoirs, rainfall pattern, climate, cropping pattern are required. The maximum intensity of storm and frequency, its frequency for a design of drainage projects. So there is a scope of hydrology. Now, hydrological cycle. Actually, we have seen this thing in earlier lectures. Again, we will revise. So the journey of water from the ocean to the atmosphere and back to the earth and ultimately to the ocean through the process of evaporation, precipitation, percolation, runoff and return to the ocean is called as a hydrological cycle. So here you can see by sunsets the evaporation takes place. Again, by this precipitation, that is by rainfall, it falls on the earth, and again infiltration takes place, then runoff is there, and the transpiration is there, and again this evaporation is there. So all this cycle is called as a hydrologic cycle. Now the types of precipitation. So first is the conventional precipitation. It results from the heating of the earth's surface. Due to this, a warm air rises rapidly to the atmosphere. As air rises, it cools, so water vapors in the air condense into the cloud and precipitation. Then second is orographic precipitation. It results when the warm moist air moving across the ocean is forced to rise by a large mountain, and as air rises, it cools. As air cools, the water vapors in the air condense and water droplets form. The precipitation occur on the windward side of the mountain. The air is now dry and rises over the top of the mountain. As air moves back down the mountain, it collects the moisture from the ground via evaporation. Then the cyclonic. Cyclonic activity causes the cyclonic rain and occur along the fronts of the cyclone. When two masses of the air of unlike density, temperature and humidity meets, then it is formed. The layers that separates them is known as the front. A warm front and the cold front are two parts of the front. At the warm front, the warm lighter wind increases slightly over the heavier cold air. As warm air rises, it cools and the moisture present in it condense to the form clouds, and then rain falls gradually for the few hours to the to a few days. So here you can see, this is the convectional precipitation, that is moist air that rises, then it meets to the coolest part, and then again by condensation the rainfall takes place. This is the orographic precipitation. These are the warm moist wind. It rises at the mountain. Again, this cold, it will be in contact with the cold air, and again it condense, and again this rainfall takes place. Again, this warm wind or warm air, which is now dry after the precipitation, that will move to the leeward side. And this is the frontal precipitation. This warm air rises over the cold front and it condense, and again this rainfall takes place. Now the rainfall measurements. So the heavy rain characteristics are, the characteristics of the storm, namely depth, duration, intensity and distribution, affect the watershed response to the rainfall event. So we need to check all these things. So what is depth? It is the amount of precipitation that falls. Usually we are measuring it into the inches or the centimeters. The duration, that is the length of the storm, usually minute, hour or the day. And the intensity, depth of the rainfall per unit time, usually in inch per hour or centimeters per hour. It is the rainfall intensity. Then it changes continuously throughout the storm, but it may average over a short time intervals or over an entire storm duration. Then the distribution. It describes how rainfall depth or intensity varies in the space over an area or watershed. So the measurement of rainfall and optimum number of rain gauges. The basic instrument for rainfall measurement is the rain gauge, which samples the incidence of the rainfall at specific point through an orifice known as of known area. The type of the rain gauges are non-recording rain gauges. The non-recording rain gauges used in India is the Simon rain gauge. The rainfall is measured every day at 8:30 hours Indian Standard Time. During heavy rains, it must be measured 3 or 4 times in a day, lest the receiver fills and overflow. But the last measurement should be at 8:30 hours Indian Standard Time. Now the recording rain gauge type. The tipping bucket rain gauge, then weighing type rain gauge and floating type rain gauge. This type of gauge is used by Indian Meteorological Department, that is IMD. So this is the Simon's rain gauge. Here you can see the brass rim is there and funnel has been installed. So what will happen in case of this heavy rainfall, this glass bottle fills at so many times. So we need to again empty and take the reading. The water collected in particular this glass bottle has been measured in the long cylinder, and that length has been measured, and that length is you might have read somewhere in the newspaper or some articles, that is it should be this much mm waterfall is rainfall is there. So this collected water has been measured in this particular that cylinder, and by that way the rainfall has been measured. This is the tipping bucket rain gauge. Here you can see again that circular collector is there. So from funnel water has been falling on this particular bucket. So as this bucket fills, it moves or rotates in the one direction, and this bucket gets empty and new bucket will be take place of that empty bucket. So how much rotation that particular bucket takes place, so by that we can measure the rainfall. Even the measuring glass is there for the that falling water from this tipping bucket. So again, this tipping bucket, it consists of the sharp edge receiver. At the end of the receiver, it provides a funnel. A pair of buckets are pivoted under the funnel in such a way that when one tipper bucket receives 2.54 mm of precipitation, it tips. and discharging it into the its contents into a reservoir, bringing the other bucket under the funnel. Tipping bucket completes an electric circuit, causing a movement of the pen to mark on the clock driven revolving drum, which carries a record chip. So this way it is recording the rain. Now the weighing bucket rain gauge. It is the most common type of the self recording gauge. The weighing bucket rain gauge essentially consists of the receiver bucket supported by a spring or any type of weighing mechanism. The movement of the bucket due to its increasing weight is transmitted to a pen, which traces the record on the clock driven chart. So here you can see, this is the weighing type bucket. So as this bucket goes down, it records the reading on this particular graph. So by this way, this particular machine or the rain gauge prepare this kind of rain recording graph. Now the float type rain gauge. The working of float type rain gauge is similar to the weighing bucket type gauge. The funnel receives the rainwater, which is collected in a rectangular container. A float is provided at the bottom of the container. The float is raised as the water level rises in the container, its movement being recorded by the pen moving on the recording drum actuated by the clockwork. When the water level in the container rises so that the float touches the top, the siphon comes into operation and releases the water. Thus, entire box is drained down. Here you can see this float moves up, and this should be recorded on the this particular drum. So as this float moves up completely, the siphon action takes place and the water is drained out. So this is the floating type rain gauge. Now the selection of rain gauge stations. So how the rain gauge station is selected? The site should be on the level ground and at open space. It should never be on the sloping ground. The site should be such that the distance between gauge stations and the objects, that is like tree or building, should at least twice the height of the object. In hilly areas where absolutely level ground is not available, site should be so selected that the station may be well shielded from the high wind. The site should be easily acceptable for the observer, and the site should be well protected by the from the cattle by wire fencing. Actually, it is not enough to provide the single rain gauge at the particular place. So different rain gauges has been installed at different places, and by summing up or by taking the average, we are calculating the rainfall. So the network of rain gauge stations should be properly designed to cover the whole area of the basin. The guidelines has been set by the World Meteorological Organization, that is WMO, for the network of rain gauge stations. So for the plain regions, one station for every 600 to 900 square meter is sufficient. For mountainous region, one station for every 100 to 250 square meter kilometer is sufficient. And for arid region, the one station for every 1500 to 10000 kilo square kilometers is sufficient. So these are the guidelines for the rain gauge, and this is all for today's lecture. Thank you.